Welcome back to my channel. I'm going to ask you a few basic questions. You answer them, develop mm-hmm. on them if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
And this is to inform the kids. So
nice.
Let's go.
I'm a first year English language and literature student at Pembroke College.
Which is where we're filming today, by the way. The first question is, how many people, we're not re-recording this, of course not.
That's crazy. Oh wait, no, just English. I thought you were saying my...
Oh no, just doing English.
Four?
Yeah.
There's just four.
Oh, I think we should do that again then. How many people do English at Pembroke?
Four, including me.
Okay, and how many do you think do it like across the uni?
Probably like 150, mm-hmm. 200.
Can you give me like a brief overview of what your course entails?
So with first year, we have four papers. We have approaches to English language and literature, which is examined via coursework. So you do like an essay on literary theory and then an essay on linguistics mm-hmm. for your coursework. Second paper, we do Old English, which I don't like
Chaucer.
Very much. No, it's no? older than Chaucer.
Older than Chaucer?
It's older than Chaucer. Chaucer's Middle English.
That's really old.
Yeah, it's old. It's old. And then we do Modern and we do Victorian. So those are the four papers for first year. Mm-hmm. And then in second year, we kind of go on to Renaissance period, mm-hmm. Restoration, and then Shakespeare stuff. Mm-hmm. So I guess the course is designed so that you literally do the very beginning of English literature, which
beginning
is
old
English.
Time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. to the very end, which is like stuff that was published like yesterday.
Really? So you have stuff like in slang?
We can, okay. Yeah, if we want. So I actually did a tutorial essay on slang for like my linguistic stuff. I looked at Stormzy's mobile speed.
Wow.
And I talked about how like...
Did you get to choose that?
Yeah, so I did. I think they're really good in Pembroke. They're really lenient and not lenient. I think that's a wrong word to use because it shouldn't be a matter of leniency.
Flexible?
Yeah, they're inclusive. Like they are flexible. You have to read for the period, but you mm-hmm. can read what you want within that given period.
That's cool. And would you say that's not across all colleges or you don't know that?
It's not across all colleges. I've talked to people in lectures who have tutors who are very fixed with their reading lists, whereas mine have been like, I can say like happily, I've had some wicked tutors who've allowed me to do so much stuff, inclusive of what is English literature and what it entails.
And then third year?
I don't know. Obviously dissertation, which takes up a massive chunk. And then I think it continues on with, you have like a special options paper. So I know you can do like postcolonial stuff or like women's stuff, or you can keep doing more Old English if you want.
I mean, you can, we won't judge you.
You guys, yeah, do what you want. But like me personally, I'm not into that. Yeah, I don't know the rest of the course, which is actually poor because I should know.
It's fine. I guess you'll dive right in. But for you guys watching this, go on the Oxford website and they should have a breakdown. What I wanted to show you is like a verbal explanation of what you're going to get yourself into. People watching this video might be applying to take English at Oxford, which is great. And you know, good luck if you do that. What advice would you give those guys?
Read. Probably sounds like an obvious option, but for English, you literally read a lot. And you read about reading and then read about reading and just keep reading. And then you write about reading as well. Like, it's a lot to do with reading. So I think the best thing that you could do is read stuff that interests you. If you have a certain text in school, for example, you have a certain author like Tennessee Williams or Shakespeare and you're really into Othello or A Streetcar Named Desire, then just look up other stuff that they've written and just go to plays and watch and go on like BBC.
We pause for a second because there's a car outside and you might be able to hear that right now. So where were we? Reading?
Yeah, read. That's the moral of the story. When you've realised that you're interested in certain movements or certain writers, certain form of literature, like whether that be the play form or poetry or novel, like or prose, for example, delve into it more. And the only way in which you can do that is read, and obviously watching plays, watching films, watching adaptations as well. That will allow you to truly fall in love with the subject. And there's no right reading list. Don't sit there and start learning the Canterbury Tales if you've never delved into it before or because you feel obliged to. Only do it out of interest. Don't do it out of like obligation.
And I think I'm right in assuming that your course doesn't have much creative writing, or is that much?
No, not at all.
Good to know. Also, what I was going to ask you is, could you give advice for people who maybe are offer holders for English at Oxford?
You probably got on a massive reading list. Read it.
Mm-hmm. The theme of this video is read.
Yeah, I know. That is literally it. Read. Like, obviously, don't read all of it because don't enter Oxford tired of reading, because it'd be the worst position to be in. Like, to come in here hating it
pace
or
yourself.
Or be, yeah, exactly. Pace yourself and.
But yeah, so read.
Read the reading list, but obviously pace yourself and don't tire yourself out.
Where were we? Bye. You were saying to read books off the reading list.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot the word for this.
Pace, tire yourself.
Pace yourself, but don't overdo it, because something that people have been saying when I've asked them this question as well is also to enjoy your summer, because this is one of the last times where you have real free time.
It's true. It's very true.
So do read, obviously prepare for Oxford. If they've given you a reading list, there's a reason for that. But also don't, I still can't think of the word I'm looking for. I'll edit it in if I do think of it later on. No, like don't overestimate yourself. So to get back onto track, because we've had a few distractions. Advice for people who are offer holders. Besides reading books from the reading list, don't read all of them, but do read what interests you. What else would you say?
reserve secondary reading for term and primary reading for VAG. So secondary reading when you're actually in Oxford in those 8 to 9 weeks, and then primary reading, so the novels, the plays, especially the novels because they're fat, especially in first term because you do Victorian first term and you do like the Victorian novels, which are usually about 1,000 pages long, so it's just peak. So do those massive novels in the holiday before, which is obviously going to be in that summer. Other things, I think just like fall in love with the subject, and the only way you can do that is by just further exploring it. Go to like galleries, exhibitions, go and see plays, especially if you're in somewhere like a city like Oxford or a city like London, which I was and still am. Like, we're very lucky in the sense that we have the opportunity to go to see plays, so see them and like listen to In Our Time on BBC. It's a really good kind of radio chat show where they talk about everything and anything.
So it's not just to do with English.
Definitely not. It's about life, yeah.
Another thing that I wanted to ask you is English is quite a well-known subject, and you know, a lot of people take it at Oxford, but there's also a lot of misconceptions about the subject. Mm. Like, maybe all you do is read, but that's kind of proven to be true by the sounds of it. What kind of misconceptions can you prove or deny? Affirm or deny?
Yeah, no, I remember coming here and just being really worried that I was going to fall out of love with the subject because I would have been forced to like read and just write like 9 million essays, not 9 million, but write a lot of essays and just tire myself out and become almost apathetic towards the subject. But that hasn't happened, despite the fact that it's been really hard and it's a really sharp learning curve. And I think one of the reasons why that hasn't happened is because we had a really interesting class in first term where we had classes at the Ashmolean Museum.
Oh, cool.
And so you would go and see like artifacts from the Victorian era. You would think, you know, context is literary. So if you think, oh, like, just to go back to Tennessee Williams, he's an American playwright, this happened, you know, after the Civil War, and the context of World War One in it, and there's context of him being gay, and there's context of this and that, and da da da. But that's not just it. There's also like material context. Mm-hmm. So when we went to the Ashmolean Museum, we literally looked at like pendants that lovers had written for each other, and then looked at it in context of like a sonnet, for example. Like, looking at stuff like that changes your perspective. We also looked at when time was first introduced in Britain as a concept, and then looking at at Emily Dickinson's poetry about death, and then it recontextualizes. Why does Emily Dickinson feel a certain way about death? Well, it's because time was never a concept before, because when the railways were introduced, that's when time became a thing.
Facts.
Like, yeah, facts. We learned facts. It's not just opinion, it's fact as well. And I think that's really important. Historicizing it is important. So we look at a lot of like historical kind of context as well, which I guess you do from A-level for most of you. Most of you are probably, you know, are taking English A-level.
Yes, so that's actually one of the questions I was going to ask you, if you don't mind. What did you do before coming to uni? Did you do A-levels?
I did A-levels.
Okay. Which subjects did you take?
In year 12, I did an AS level in textiles, which is basically like...
That's cool.
It's mad, yeah. So I literally like made clothes.
They didn't offer that in my school.
I literally made clothes, and now I'm in Oxford, so... I mean, I remember being told by so many people like, oh my god, are you sure like you want to do textiles, like you're an academic? Academics don't do that. You don't do that as an AS level. You should have done something else, like to complement your humanities subjects. But I was like, I'm literally just going to do what I want. Like, why?
And what were the other ones, the humanities stuff?
So then I did 3 A levels, like the entire 2 years, Spanish, philosophy and ethics, and English literature.
But yeah, do you think that your subjects equipped you well for doing English here? And would you recommend a different combination of subjects? Or does it not matter at all?
Ooh, that's really interesting.
I'm good with questions.
You are. History would be really useful in terms of sources, looking at sources. So I just gave the example of understanding material context. You know, we've gone to museums, we literally went to the British Library as well to look at like old English manuscripts.
Is this part of your
as part of my degree. Like,
did they organise that?
My college organised the trip all the way to the British Library. We all went to London for a day.
That's really cool.
And yeah, and we like looked at old English manuscripts. So I literally saw the first time someone had written something in anything close to English.
And do you know if that's common across other colleges to do trips like that?
No,
it's not.
No, so we're already lucky.
What I'm hearing is Pembroke and English. You know, I'm not saying, but I kind of am saying.
Kind of.
But also explore your options, because every college is suited to different people, I guess. And you know, they're all good.
Yeah.
And if they offer the subject, it means that they're good at offering it. Mm. Well, if they offer the subject, it means that they're able to offer it. I had to take it back a bit. I'm getting weird.
To add on to that, with colleges, find out on the college website what your tutors from that college specifically do their research in. So my tutor, who tutors me in Victorian and modern, Dr. Shashi Dasgupta, I knew she was one of the many few women of colour on the course, like in the department, and I knew what her interests were in Victorian, like she loves space and like Dickens, and I like that vibe.
Mm-hmm.
So I made sure to pick according to that.
That's
as well.
That's useful, yeah. Because she teach you or give you
tutors. She teaches me, like she properly like took my papers.
That's cool.
No, 3 of my papers.
Oh wow. Because something I would add on that aspect is that, like, I guess for subjects like English, big subjects where you are taught in your college, I guess this is quite important.
Yeah.
For a subject like mine, like Chinese studies, your tutors, what what their interests are, and if they go to your college, isn't such a big deal because you'll be taught by other tutors from other colleges, and you don't get taught in college anyway, you get taught in your department.
Mm.
So just to compare. And also the whole museum thing, we didn't go on trips to London and stuff for our course, Chinese that is. However, we did have a few lessons in Ashwellian. Mm. Like we had a few lectures there, and depending on the subjects you choose in like third year, if you do the art option for instance, you will go to the Ashwellian sometimes.
Mm.
And that's also for other subjects like Egyptology, my friend did that and she had lessons in Ashwellian sometimes. So,
that's so cool.
I guess what I'm trying to tell you is that at Oxford, not all the subjects are like confined to a classroom in a tutorial system.
Mm.
Most of them are, but sometimes you can like branch out and do hands-on things.
And I also think that's the beauty of humanities in general. We are able to branch out of the classroom, but in really different ways. Oxford's known for like the Ashmolean Museum.
Yeah. If you come to visit Oxford, go take a look at it. It's quite big. They have so many different things. They have like things from different countries and different periods of time and stuff.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I really like that space.
The next thing I was going to ask you is, could you share some information either about Oxford or English at Oxford that you wish you knew before you came here?
Okay, there's a few things.
We're here for it.
Maybe not just about English, but about Oxford as a whole as well. I'm the only ethnic minority on my course in my college, but not only that, like, I'm one of what, like, 10, 15, 20 out of like a cohort of 150 or so, which in Oxford terms is kind of good, which is really, that's the bad part, it's kind of good. But it was so scary to me to like be in a, to grow up in a classroom in East London where everyone was from like similar backgrounds, and then to come here and just be, that's the bell.
You were talking about how it's a bit uncomfortable, or it was uncomfortable when you first arrived here, because you were the only person of colour, or one of the few people of colour in a cohort that's quite large and quite...
It was just scary, like, to move from a classroom where you are the norm to a classroom where you are an absolute alien. That just took a bit of a toll on me in the first few weeks of term. I just didn't feel like I belonged to the classroom as much. When I went to classes, I didn't feel like I was allowed to have the audacity to speak, which now looking back is really stupid, but
I mean, like,
I didn't feel like I was allowed to speak.
It's valid, like, it's not stupid, and I feel like a lot of people probably think this way.
I guess that's just imposter syndrome, like,
it's imposter syndrome, but then it also, it went over time, like, you don't really feel like that anymore.
Yeah, it does go, it goes, it definitely goes.
So what are some of the things you think helped you to get over those feelings of imposter syndrome, which I've mentioned in other videos, but in short, it's like when you question why you're here. It's not just a thing for Oxford, but like, let's just say you got a promotion at work, you're like, why did I get that? I don't deserve it, blah 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 blah.
You just have to acknowledge that you've worked really hard, and probably harder than a lot of the people here, and it's quite simple. Like, you've come from a background, an education system, financially, cultural capital wise, in every sense of the word, you've come from a background in which coming here was much harder than it is for a lot of the people here. And then you realize that and have that epiphany, and you're like, oh wow, like, I'm actually like really smart and I'm meant to be here. And it takes a long time to get to the point where you acknowledge and accept you are special. You're not different. You're different because you're special. You're different because you're unique. You're not just different because you're an alien or because you don't belong. It's because you're special. So it's about, kind of realizing that. And that happens when you find like-minded people, when you have those conversations, when you vent. We vent a lot here. We rant a lot in this place. Once you have those conversations, then like you feel a lot better about how you fit in.
It gets better.
It's improved. It does get better.
It improved for you.
It does.
Yay.
It did.
That's good. So I guess that's most of my questions, to be honest. What I was going to say next is, if there's anything you want to share that we haven't already touched on that you think might be useful for, again, somebody who's watching this is probably interested in doing English at Oxford, then feel free to please share. I don't have to do much editing for these videos, but I will like get out all the cuts and stuff.
Yeah, okay, cool. One of the things I would say is, I can honestly say, like, with chest, even after doing prelims last week, that...
Which are the first two exams, by the way.
They took a toll on me, because they were the first ever time I'd experienced, like, the examination experience.
Oh yeah, I know you were messaging
at Oxford,
me.
Yeah.
We were organising, filming this, and then I just finished my finals, which are, like, your last exams at Oxford.
Mm.
And you were like, how am I so stressed when you literally have finals?
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Prelims, I think this is across the board, right? They don't count towards your degree, but they are still important at Oxford, because they're your first time to be properly examined, and, like, find out where you are, and you have to pass them. But you did that.
I did it. But I literally did it last week, and it was just the most horrible week of my life.
Oh.
But like, I can honestly say, even despite that, like, I actually love my subject.
Yeah. How many exams did you have?
Oh, yeah. English
reading prelims. Okay, three. You get three.
Three 3-hour exams, by the way.
Okay. And if you have extra time, then it's a bit more than that.
And then a few weeks before that, I had to submit my coursework, which was rough as well. So like, despite the fact that the examination period towards the end was very, very rough, like, I can properly say I have loved my degree. Like,
okay.
This first year of my degree, I genuinely love it. Like, I love the subject. And the way in which we're taught just forces you to think about texts and to think about your own opinion, your own interpretation, context, you just think about it in a different way. Oxford's really cool. They have this ability to teach us how to think and how to think better. How to articulate your like thinking.
Very true.
I didn't know how to articulate my thinking or my opinion properly. And I feel like now I do like better than I did at the beginning of the year. So I've loved my degree.
It's only gonna get better from there.
Hopefully.
But yeah, I think that is all for this video. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you, Mintu, for joining me. I guess see you in the next one. I hope this helped you. If it did, then you know, give it a like and all that kind of stuff. Subscribe. Share this with your friends and see you next time. That bell.
That bell is being jarring.
That bell. Ugh. If you come to Oxford, get used to the bells.
Yeah.
Good luck. Hi. Hi. Don't be scared.
What is... So look at this. I'm a mess.
What? Why?
So what happened was I went to the bathroom and I was washing my hands and I couldn't turn off the tap. And then what happened was
I made
the tap stronger and then I opened the other tap as well and it just went like Moses. And then I'm really wet now. But
what can you tell?
It's fine. Should I check? So my scarf will have a design on it now. Oh, and so all my clothes.
Like, wait. But it's fine. You know, it's all good. I move on. This is what I do for you guys. Can they tell?
Is it traffic?
Oh, bless. I'm just gonna wait.
Doing a bit of a 3-point turn.
Oh, one more. Oh, wow. They're coming from everywhere.
Great. Great, mate.
We good? Wow, that person's wheel is squeaking. Is that safe?
No, that's a duck, mate, no?
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
That's quite loud.
The ducks are... I thought it was a woman once. Because it was going, ah, ah, but it was just a duck.
That's like outside my house, there's cats sometimes, and I thought it was a whale. But then I was like, why would there be a whale?
Whale. No.
Should be calm. I think we're good.
I don't know what's going on.
That couldn't have been. I think that's the baby.
That's
not a duck.
Yeah, that's a baby. That's not a duck.
If you guys heard that, tell me what you think that was, because we can't really see.
Wow, Mika.
Why are you coming here for?
Why are you coming here, Mika?
Is
he going to open the window?
I'm not opening the window for you.
Cheeky.
Do you think he was making a sound?
No. Go. No. You're sending him love hearts. I'll just put middle finger up. He did his beard. Look.
What does that mean? I can't even tell.
Can you not? Okay.
Did he shave it? Yeah. Trim it?
He's changed.
Should we just make it look like we're talking about him?
Yeah, I just hate him so much. He's such an idiot. Did you see him in the video?
He ate the film.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, it was just he was hilarious though, because he just was running around trying to give everyone hands. He's really funny though. You know, he came to my room like a few days ago, like just out of exhaustion. I found him on my bed, just like this.
Without you knowing?
Like this. And he's like, oh yeah. Yeah, sorry. I was just thinking about all the synonyms. I was going to say something else. Yeah, save the... Ooh.
Hello?
Honestly. Is that him?
That's a baby.
Is that what the sound was?
I'm really confused.
That's a baby.
This is great, isn't it?
Can't film anywhere these days. He's trying to do an innocent video about English at Oxford and we've got music in the background.
It's proving to be an impossible task.
Floors make sounds.
Oh my god, Mika's back!
Is he?
Hey, yo!
He's back.
He's back.
That's his friend. You know what? Don't give them attention.
That I'm depressed friend.
Exposed.
Look at what
he's doing. Such a meme.
He's walking like so suave. He's like, yeah,
please.
Look at me with my two female friends.
Okay. You know, filming here is really interesting.
I know, it's a Pembroke experience.
Oh wow. It's gonna go on for quite a while. Is that coming from Christchurch?
No, because it's 9 o'clock now. No, it's the church, it's this church right here.
That's the church. Yeah. Oh my god, it is. Yeah, we host ISOC events there sometimes, which is a bit mad. But
that's
I feel
so sick. ISOC events
I feel
church.
Like that's like, what's it called? Religious cohesion going on.
No, I love that stuff.
Every year we have like a freshers formal, I think that's what they call it, at the start of the term, which is like a big dinner
church.
To get to know all the freshers, like for them to meet each other, and it's the Catholic
chaplaincy.
That's
so sweet.
Get to know, I have a picture with the Pope. Fake Pope.
Oh.
A cardboard cutout of the Pope.
Oh.
Might put it there, but yeah, it's from that event.
I thought it was the actual Pope who rolled up to
maybe
me,
one
to
day,
it.
If he will let me.
Probably
don't. Yeah, Oxford's great, but their lighting though. But moving on, because if you want to do biology, I guess that's good. But you probably aren't because you're here for this video. That was like the longest setup time I've ever done in my life. Should we start?
And I think all the water's dried now.
That's it. Well, I think it's gone.
Wow. English is that subject, okay?